Hey traders, my name is Matthew from Pine Script Master, and in this video today I'm going to show you some content from my Pine Script Mastery course, where I'm going to break down the study annotation function and explain all the various parameters that we have to work with. But before we begin, I should mention that if you enjoy this content, there's plenty more available over at pinescriptmastery.com, including a free basics course for beginners. So go and check that out if it's something that interests you. But for now, let's get into the content. So hey coders, welcome to the very first Pine Script coding lesson in this course. This lesson is going to cover the study annotation function, which is this guy down here. So I'm going to explain what this does and how to use it and what all the input parameters do. So this study function is what Pine Script refers to as a annotation function. So similar to this as an annotation comment, which tells it's a compiler directive. It tells the Pine Script compiler what version of Pine Script we're using, in this case, version 4, the latest version as of making this course. The study function does a similar thing. It tells Pine Script all of the code that follows this study annotation function is to be treated as a study script, or in other words, an indicator script, as opposed to a strategy script. So if we were to make a strategy script, we would have access to different functions, such as all these strategy calls. But we're not doing that today. We're going to cover strategy much later in the course. So today we're just working with the study function. So first of all, what inputs does the study annotation function take? It takes two titles. It takes an overlay Boolean input. It takes a text format input. It takes a precision input, a scale input, and a max bars back input. So those are the parameters we have to work with, and I'll explain what each of them do one by one. So the first input parameter is a title, and this is the only input parameter that is required. So if you don't have this title and you try to save your script, it won't work. We'll get an error. So this first title input is the name of the script, and you can call it whatever you want. So in this case, I'm going to call it Pine Script Mastery Course Study Example and hit save. And you'll see up here, our script name is now changed to PSMC Study Example. Now you don't need to have the title equals here. We could just do that and that would also work. But just for clarity's sake, I'm going to leave that in because we also have access to the short title. So I'll show what that does now. Short title is set to, let's call this study. And now if I hit save, that'll change the name of our script to just study. And so the reason there's two titles is that the main title is for explaining in detail what your script name is. The short title is for an abbreviation on your chart. So for example, I have an indicator called the ultimate pullback indicator, but that's a long name to have. It clutters up your chart a fair bit. So what I've used the short title for is to abbreviate it to UPI. And so when you use my ultimate pullback indicator, that's all you get on your chart is UPI. So that's the purpose of the short titles, to abbreviate any long script names you come up with. So that's those two input parameters. The next input parameter is overlay. So by default, overlay is set to false. And what this means is that our script will draw into its own window pane, its own box. As you can see here, it's drawing in its own oscillator type box. So this is useful for scripts like the RSI, stochastics, even volume, that sort of thing. But if you want to draw onto your actual chart, you have to set this to true. So if I set this to true and I hit save, first of all, I need to remove the script for this parameter to update. And if we click add to chart, the script is now drawing the closing price to the chart instead of into its own oscillator box. So I hit save again. And I remove the script, add it back. Now it's in its own box. So that's what the overlay parameter does. The next input is the format input. So this is for setting how the values, number values, are formatted when they're drawn to your chart. So we only have two formatting options. If you type format dot control space, technically three, inherit, price, and volume. By default, it's set to inherit, which will inherit your chart axis formatting, but you can override this with whichever formatting type you want. So if we set this to format.volume and hit save, you can see that it's now drawing a one down here. If I change this to say 20,000, hit save. You can see that it now puts a K on the end. And if we were to change this to say 20,420 and we hit save, now it says 20.42K. That's useful for creating indicators like a volume indicator or anything that works with volume, that sort of thing. Because if you set this to price and hit save, then we'll get the exact number there. So for most scripts, you're going to want this exact number, but for other scripts, especially ones working with volume, this formatting volume format can be helpful. So I'll leave this as inherit for now. So if I set this back to plot the closing price and we move on, I will show you what the next input does, which is precision. So the next input parameter is precision, and this specifies how much precision to go into with your decimal values. So if you were to set this to 2, it's going to cut all these decimal digits in the indicator value, and it's going to round the number up to the nearest 2 digits. So if I hit save, you'll see that this number will just become 0.69. And then as it gets closer to 70, it rounds up to 70 there. So we only have 2 decimal digits, and that's what precision does. We go all the way to 1. And then we'll just get 0.7 because it's rounding up 0.69 to 7. So for most instruments on your chart, most markets, a precision of 5 is about as much as you will ever need, but you can go higher if you want to. We could go to 6. I'm not sure what the maximum precision is, but it's a lot. There we have a precision of 10. That might be helpful for analyzing cryptocurrency markets, maybe like Satoshis on some cryptocurrency markets. By default, this is set to whatever your price axis is. So I'll leave that as 5 for now. And we'll move on to the next input parameter, which is scale. Now this parameter tells PineScript which scale to attach your indicator values to. So we have a number of options here. By default, it's set to your main price scale. But if I type in scale and then control space, that'll bring up the list of scales we have to choose from. So if I set the scale to scale.left and I save the chart, save the script, and I remove the script from my chart, add it back on. Now you can see that the indicator values are plotting to the left scale. So that's what this input parameter does. It allows you to move which scale that your indicator value is attached to. So the final input parameter we can work with is max bars back. So if you type in max underscore bars underscore back, this determines how far back your script can reference historical bars. So if I set this to 5, now our script can only reference the past 5 historical bars. So that will be the maximum amount of historical values we can go back. So it's very unlikely you will ever have to use this input parameter. I'm not even sure why it's included, but I'm sure there's a reason for it. Maybe for saving the amount of memory that a script uses when calculating its values. If your script is failing to execute because it's running into PineScript's computer resource limitations, maybe you will use this feature. But that is all of the study annotation input parameters we have to work with. For your average indicator, you will only really be working with these 3 values: your main title, your short title, and overlay. That's the most common 3 inputs I use in my own scripts anyway. So that's it for this lesson. I hope you found that helpful. If you did, and you want to learn more about PineScript, head over to pinescriptmastery.com. Here you'll find my advanced PineScript courses and my basics course, which is free. So if you want to learn more about PineScript, head over here and you'll find out a little bit more about me and a little bit more about PineScript. I hope you found this lesson interesting and helpful. I'll see you in the next one.